main screen. Speaking into the microphone activates the camera displaying the speaker on the main screen. Do not stop your remarks if you do not immediately see the screen switch. If the screen does not change after seconds, please make sure you are not muted. To minimize background noise and ensure the correct speaker is being displayed, we ask that you remain on mute unless you have sought recognition. Myself or staff that we have designated may mute participants' microphones when they are not under recognition to eliminate inadvertent background noise. Members who are virtual are responsible for muting and unmuting themselves. If I notice when you are recognized that you have not unmuted yourself, I will ask the staff to send you a request to unmute yourself. Please then accept that request so you are no longer muted. I remind all members and witnesses that the 5-minute clock still applies. If there is a technology issue, we will move to the next member until the issue is resolved and you'll retain the balance of your time. Finally, House rules require me to remind you that we have set up an email address to which members can send anything they wish in writing at any of our hearings or markups. That email address has been provided in advance to your staff. So welcome again, Madam Ambassador, and good morning. This is our hearing with our Ambassador to the United Nations, Linda Thomas-Greenfield. We're gonna discuss the administration's fiscal 2023 request supporting the United States diplomatic engagement at the United Nations, its specialized agencies and programs, and UN peacekeeping activities. Ambassador Thomas-Greenfield, on behalf of myself and my colleagues, I want to thank you for joining us today and for bringing your many decades of experience in development and diplomacy to such a critically important post at such a critical time. The United Nations is an invaluable and irreplaceable platform for fostering diplomacy and international peace. And I've been privileged to serve as the United States Congressional Representative to the UN General Assembly on the Democratic side on 5 different occasions. And so I've seen firsthand the importance of the issues debated in New York and how much is at stake without UN engagement. After an historic global pandemic that has devastated health systems, crippled economies, reignited racial and ethnic divisions, and tragically claimed the lives of over 15 million people, the role and mission of the United Nations are as essential now as they were when the United Nations was first created after the aftermath of World War II. That's why I'm very pleased to see that the administration's fiscal 23 request fully funds or provides necessary increases in the UN-related accounts, including our assessed and voluntary contributions to UN organizations and UN peacekeeping missions. The request includes funds to begin paying down our unpaid debts for peacekeeping that have accumulated over the last 5 years and have now reached over $1 billion, which is, yes, a staggering amount. This subcommittee has long recognized the vital role UN peacekeepers play in conflict zones and the benefits that we gain with burden sharing with other countries through UN peacekeeping missions. We simply cannot continue to tout these multilateral partnerships while at the same time maintain arbitrary caps on our contributions and rack up millions of dollars in arrears, leaving other countries to foot the bill. Not paying our dues weakens our ability to lead on a host of international issues and cedes ground to our strategic competitors. Speaking of ceding ground, I'm deeply concerned that we will not achieve the Sustainable Development Goals by 2030 now that the COVID pandemic has caused tremendous backsliding. So Ambassador Thomas-Greenfield, I'm eager to hear about your conversations with UN partners on how we get the SDGs back on track and how the fiscal 23 resources will help. I also hope you will update our subcommittee on the UN's response to the devastating invasion of Ukraine, as well as the UN's ongoing global response to COVID-19, especially in terms of vaccine distribution, rebuilding health systems, and addressing the second order impacts, including rising rates of gender-based violence, illiteracy, malnutrition, and job loss, all of which has disproportionately affected women around the world. Now, Secretary Blinken said during his first major speech as Secretary of State that, and I quote, "We're always better off at the table, not outside of the room." I could not agree more, which is why I fully supported the administration rejoining the Paris Agreement, the World Health Organization, and the UN Human Rights Council. As chairwoman, I also fully support the United States playing a leadership role through our contributions to organizations like UNRWA and UNFPA, both of which were needlessly cut off during the previous administration in order to score domestic political points at the expense of millions of people who depend on these institutions. Throughout my time in Congress, I have consistently advocated for the strongest possible partnerships between the United States and the United Nations. I encourage my colleagues to think carefully about calls for America to unilaterally cede the field at these international bodies to governments which work against our values. We may not always agree with other nations on every issue, but we must always have a venue where we can hear from other countries and be heard ourselves. America is not always perfect or a consistent voice for human rights, but we can and we have been vocal and persuasive. We need to keep making the case for human rights and human dignity. So Ambassador Thomas Greenblatt, I want to thank you once again for your leadership, your devotion to diplomacy, and for your testimony today. So before we hear from you, let me turn to my colleague, Ranking Member Rogers, for his opening statement.
I'm glad that we were able to be here face to face to receive your testimony and discuss the 023 budget request for the UN and other international organizations. You're serving at an extraordinary time that highlights both the many flaws and weaknesses of the United Nations, but the important life-saving work of some of its organizations, such as the UN Children's Fund and the World Food Program. These and other international organizations perform many valuable tasks that often have bipartisan support. This good work, however, is often overshadowed by the UN's longstanding weaknesses, including on matters of war and peace. In particular, Russia's unprovoked assault on Ukraine has highlighted yet again the inability of the Security Council to be meaningful in addressing wars of aggression. They're simply not there. Perhaps Moscow's brazen challenge to international peace and security will prompt a rethinking of our international institutions and how we can make the UN and related mechanisms more responsive to the demands of our time. Any such efforts could start by addressing the UN's chronic problems of bureaucratic red tape, inefficiency, and lack of transparency and accountability. There could not be a more glaring example of these problems than the recent scandal at the UN Office for Project Services, which, according to press accounts, engaged in several bizarre insider deals that may cost the organization tens of millions of dollars. At a time when there's increased scrutiny of U.S. foreign aid here at home, stories like this, at best, feed the sentiment that tax dollars are being wasted and at worst are used to work against our own interests. While the U.S. Ambassador to the UN for Management and Reform has called for a comprehensive review of that agency, a broader review of UN agencies and practices has long been in order. For example, the World Health Organization received criticism from around the world for its failed response to the coronavirus pandemic. Many eminent experts called on the WHO to take action on transparency and desperately needed reforms. I hope you can update us on the recent World Health Assembly and whether any meaningful reforms were addressed. Similarly, while the Secretary General has sought to strengthen peacekeeping operations, it's unclear whether these efforts have improved overall performance and accountability of these important but complex and increasingly expensive undertakings that seem to continue in perpetuity. Then there's the UN Human Rights Council, to which the United States returned as a member late last year. The good news is that in light of its war crimes in Ukraine, the General Assembly voted to suspend Russia from the Council. The bad news is that despite a commitment by the administration to address a long and sordid history of anti-Israel bias there, the Council is moving in the wrong direction, continuing these efforts through an expansive and deeply biased Commission of Inquiry, investigating the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Instead of unjustly targeting Israel, the Council would be better advised to investigate Communist China's ongoing genocide against Uyghur Muslims in China's Xinjiang province. Unfortunately, the six-day visit of the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights to China has widely been seen as a failure and roundly criticized for not only undermining her credibility, but the overall credibility of the UN on human rights. And the list goes on. What is required are meaningful reforms, which address the issues I've mentioned, while making better use of scarce taxpayer resources to advance the causes that we support. To that end, I should note that the $4.5 billion requested for fiscal 23 for the UN and other international organizations is an increase of nearly $1 billion over the current level. In the absence of meaningful reforms across these institutions, such increases cannot be justified. I look forward to working with you and the chair to identify a common ground for funding that is in our national interest and advances reforms to increase transparency and efficacy. Before I close, Madam Chair, I want to address the nuclear threats from Iran and North Korea. I understand that Iran may have reached the point at which it could develop a nuclear weapon in a matter of weeks. I hope you can speak to us on this issue, including whether the International Atomic Energy Agency would be in any position to verify a nuclear agreement with Iran, assuming that such an agreement is still within reach and a goal of the administration. Likewise, not only is the IAEA deeply concerned about ongoing nuclear weapons development in North Korea, which expelled the agency in 2009, but Pyongyang has also continued to aggressively develop its ballistic missile program in violation of UN sanctions. I would also appreciate an update of our efforts in the Security Council to enact further penalties on North Korea in response to these developments. Ambassador, thank you for being here with us today. Thank you for your longstanding service to the country and for your hard work, especially exceptionally challenging times to advance American interests at the UN. Thank you for your service.
Thank you, Mr. Rogers. Now I will ask our witness, Ambassador Thomas Greenfield, to make her presentation, and thank you very much for again being here. We'll include your full written statement in the record. You'll be recognized now for 5 minutes to summarize your opening statement, so please proceed.
To advance U.S. interests and address global challenges. We have not shied away from pushing for comprehensive reforms to make these institutions more transparent and accountable to U.S. taxpayers. And along with our allies and partners, we've tackled a range of challenges head on, including public health threats, climate change, conflicts, and humanitarian crises around the world. In just over a year and a half at the UN, I have met with senior representatives from nearly every member state. I've been able to strengthen long-standing relationships and forge new ones. And so when crises have emerged, we have been ready. Before President Putin carried out his further invasion of Ukraine, the U.S. went to the Security Council to expose Russia's plans to the world. And after he launched this unprovoked, unlawful, and brutal war, we mobilized over 140 member states to condemn Moscow's action, and it was a unified and historic vote, bigger than anyone could have expected. We then led efforts to suspend Russia from the Human Rights Council, and we're continuing to use every tool at our disposal to hold Russia's forces accountable. This multilateral strategy is effective, not just in supporting Ukraine, but across the board. Our multilateral engagements help lead to truces, however fragile, in Ethiopia and Yemen that have allowed for the delivery of urgently needed humanitarian assistance. And the UN, in partnership with the G7, has helped us respond to the recent spike in global food insecurity, another consequence of Russia's war of aggression. Just last month at the UN, Secretary Blinken hosted the Global Food Security Call to Action Ministerial, where we rallied the world to respond to this worsening crisis. Over 80 countries have aligned with our roadmap to combat global food insecurity, which calls for increased humanitarian assistance and in-kind food donations, among other actions. On nearly every issue in conflict, our multilateral engagement is delivering concrete outcomes for the U.S. and helping advance our values around the world. But let me be crystal clear. China and Russia are working day and night to drive an alternative authoritarian agenda at the UN and other multilateral institutions, and they're putting significant resources and personnel behind their efforts. Right now at the UN, to paraphrase President Biden, we are in a fight for the soul of the world. It would be a grave mistake to cede the UN and other multilateral fora to China, which is why the president's budgets ask for the resources and authorities needed to assert U.S. leadership. Currently, our failure to live up to our financial obligations at the UN give our adversaries an easy talking point, one they hit us with again and again. We need to be able to pay our bills in full and on time, and this will bolster our credibility and our leadership. The president's budget also asks for additional support for UN peacebuilding efforts, a worthwhile investment that helps prevent costly conflicts before they erupt. And it asks for authority and funding to enable U.S. leadership in organizations like UNESCO. In the absence of U.S. leadership, China and others have been more assertive at UNESCO, seeking to shape international consensus on issues like emerging technologies and artificial intelligence in ways hostile to democratic values. We need a seat at the table when international standards and best practices are being set so that we can advance our values. Finally, we have a series of personnel requests in this budget, including much needed increases in housing allowances for Foreign Service officers in New York, and investments that will allow more young and diverse Americans to serve at the United Nations. These are modest budget requests, but they speak to a larger priority. We need to attract and retain the best and the brightest if we're going to continue to be successful. And with the support of this subcommittee, we will continue to be successful at leading the world the American way. And with that, I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam Ambassador. We'll now proceed in the standard 5-minute rounds, alternating sides, recognizing members in order of seniority as they joined or were seated at the beginning of the hearing. And I'm asking everyone to be mindful of your time and allow the witnesses time to answer within your 5-minute turn. I know the ambassador has a hard stop at about 11:30. So I'll start now with, and we probably will only have one round of questions. So I'll try to summarize my questions, several of them. They all have to do with the impact of U.S. engagement at the United Nations. As I said in my opening statement, it's critical that we have a seat at the table, as you said, not just to have our voice heard, but to shape the very issues being debated. With this in mind, Ambassador Thomas Greenfield, from your experience over the last year and a half, one, we have been able to accomplish, what have we been able to accomplish since rejoining the UN Human Rights Council and paying our human rights-related arrears? Secondly, how has the United Nations played a role in ended COVID pandemic and in trying to get the SDGs back on track? Thirdly, and lastly, what key reforms have we been able to advance by your presence or by our presence under your leadership, especially those focused on holding offenders accountable for sexual abuse committed by peacekeeping forces? And of course, if you'd like to reference Ukraine and Poland and the refugee crisis, please feel free to do so. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me just start with how we have engaged to shape how the UN responds to crises. I have made a concerted effort, as I noted in my statement, to engage with every single member of the Council. There are 183 member states. I've already reached out to more than 130 with one-on-one meetings. One, to share with them what our priorities are, but also to encourage them to support us as we try to make the UN into a more responsive organization. And I think those efforts have paid off. They paid off when we took the condemnation of Russia to the General Assembly, and we got 141 states to support that effort. It paid off significantly when we voted to remove and suspend Russia from the Human Rights Council. In the Human Rights Council, we were able to get a commission of inquiry set up to review the situation in Russia. And we've been able to bring about some key reforms across the UN that relates to sexual abuse and sexual exploitation. We engage in all of those meetings. Congressman Rogers talked about the work of my MR ambassador, who has been working aggressively in the Fifth Committee to ensure that the UN is more transparent and more responsive to our needs. On the issue of sexual abuse and sexual exploitation, we had an extraordinary meeting of the Security Council this week where we talked about the sexual abuse of women in conflict, and Ukraine, of course, loomed large in all of that. The fact that Russian soldiers have been committing acts of violence and sexual abuse against women and children in the Ukraine. And we were able to expose that very significantly in the Council. In the UN peacekeeping operations, we've also been very, very aggressively engaged in holding countries accountable when their soldiers commit abuses against civilians. And we've been involved in having some of those peacekeeping soldiers, countries remove from operations because they are not holding their soldiers accountable. I will admit that there's a lot more work to do, but we are working aggressively to make sure that our voice is heard at the table and that we push back against any action that goes against the core values that we stand for at the United Nations.
Could you just mention Ukraine and the United Nations gearing up to address the refugee crisis?
So more than, thank you very much, Representative. More than 14 million Ukrainians have been impacted by this unprovoked war. And while the UN was a bit slow to action, I will note that this has only been 100 days, and in that 100 days, they have galvanized their staff and ramped up their operations to provide humanitarian assistance, to provide protection assistance to those who have been impacted by this war, most of them women and children. I visited Romania and Moldova, met with UN officials. I expressed our concerns that we felt that, and many of you felt, that they were not rising to the challenge. They heard us loudly and clearly. They put the staff in place, and we're seeing that they have improved and are aggressively supporting those who have been impacted.
Thank you very much for clarifying that. I was in Poland probably a month ago, and learn just that, and I really think that they're doing a great job in helping with this crisis. So thank you again. I'll yield now to our ranking member, Mr. Rogers. Thank you.
President Zelensky of Ukraine has criticized the UN peace and security architecture, arguing that the goals set in 1945 during the creation of a global international security organization have not been achieved. It is impossible to achieve them without reforms, he says, and he's right. Russia's barbarous invasion and slaughter of Ukrainians has energized decades-old demands by supporters of international justice and peace that the world's governments repair long-acknowledged weaknesses in the world's institutions for preventing and sanctioning wars of aggression. And we're in the midst of perhaps one of the worst in history in the world in Ukraine, and yet the UN security operation sits idle, unable to speak. Central to the system is the UN Security Council. Its rules, written after World War II, provide for five victors in that war: Britain, China, France, Russia, and the U.S. The power, each of them, to veto any proposed U.N. action. In addition to the five permanent members, 10 other seats have no veto power and are rotated among other U.N. member countries. Since 1946, the permanent five that I've mentioned have used their veto power 262 times, in many cases to block challenges to their own actions, including military force. Human rights defenders note that the use of or threat of a veto repeatedly has obstructed UN action to halt these mass atrocities. It was Russia's veto of a Security Council resolution in February that prevented the UN from taking concrete steps against it, such as globally binding economic sanctions. Ukraine and its allies managed a moral victory by gathering a rare consensus of 141 nations to condemn Russia's attack, with only four countries joining Russia in opposing the declaration. Yet they vetoed it. What do we need to do, Madam Ambassador, to correct this incredible fix that we're in at the UN?
Thank you for that question, and it's a tough question, but I think it goes without saying that we are working aggressively to address some of those shortcomings. And as I've said many times in the Security Council and elsewhere, Russia's veto can't stop us from exposing their actions. And the 141 votes against Russia in the General Assembly, they couldn't veto. It was a very strong condemnation of their actions. They're isolated in the Security Council. They feel it. I would not want to be sitting in the Russian PR's chair right now as he sat and listened to every single member of the Security Council condemn him, even those countries that are supporting him with their vote. Condemn the actions that they have taken. Also, you will be glad to hear we co-sponsored a resolution with the country of Liechtenstein that calls for Security Council members who use their veto to come before the General Assembly and explain to the world why they vetoed actions that would stand in the way of peace and security. And Russia and China will call before the General Assembly yesterday because they vetoed a DPRK resolution condemning and calling for actions on DPRK. So we're looking at what reforms might be put in place over the coming years. We support reforms that will help this organization work
better. Right now, the world opinion, unlike anything in the past, is so strong against Russia and what they're doing in Ukraine. It's a great opportunity for us to seize on that unpopularity that they have and point out how weak the UN is because of these rules. But there's a moment in time, and it's now, where we can really make a case against Russia and the UN to change those rules.
Sir, I agree with you. And we do see this as the moment to start to do that. And we are starting to have discussions on what kinds of reforms we can move forward that will limit the possibilities of a country like Russia, who sits on the Security Council, sitting in a seat that they really have diminished in terms of peace and security. So. This is something that we greatly support and will be working to address over the coming year.
Godspeed.
I now yield to Ms. Meng from New York.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. Thank you, Ambassador, for your testimony here today. Today, there are 2.4 billion young people ages 10 to 29 in the world, the largest youth population in our history. In countries facing conflict, it will be young people who will bear the burden of sustaining peace over generations, leading their society from reconciliation to prosperity. In 2015, the UN Security Council adopted Resolution 2250, recognizing the essential role of young people in preventing and resolving conflicts and in sustaining peace. This inspired my bill, the Youth Peace and Security Act, to ensure that the U.S. promotes the inclusive and meaningful participation of youth in mediation and negotiation processes that prevent, mitigate, or resolve conflict overseas. Ambassador, how will you ensure the U.S. adheres to the goals outlined in Resolution 2250, specifically to give youth a greater voice in decision-making at the local, national, region, and international levels, and to establish mechanisms that would enable youth to participate meaningfully in peace processes?
Thank you so much for that question, and thank you for the bill that you supported on this. This is an important area for the UN, but equally important for the United States. As you know, I served as the Assistant Secretary for African Affairs in the Obama administration, and one of our key programs was the Young African Leaders Initiative, where we have brought thousands of young Africans to the table to talk about their plans for the future of their country and for their continent. I will be meeting with a group of young people in LA this week as well from Latin America. To again hear from them what they're doing. We at the UN have ensured that we bring young people to speak to us at the United Nations. We've had civil society, youth civil society groups come before us to speak, and we absolutely are committed to supporting Resolution 2250. It is an important resolution when we look at the fact that in Africa the median age is 19, and many young people don't have hope because of the lack of opportunity. So we do have to do more in that area, and I'm committed to doing that.
Thank you so much. Events from Afghanistan to Haiti are increasing insecurity for women. And since the outbreak of COVID-19, violence against women and girls, particularly domestic violence, has intensified. We need a global collective effort to stop it. Both the United Nations Trust Fund to End Violence Against Women and UN Women have played an important role as the only global grant-making mechanism exclusively dedicated to eradicating this scourge. Nevertheless, the Biden administration's request for U.S. contributions to both important UN entities remain flat for fiscal year 23. I've requested that our contributions to both entities be significantly increased in my submissions to our chair and ranking member for fiscal year 23. Ambassador, can you please provide some additional context as to the administration's decision not to increase its contributions to these entities for fiscal year 23, and how can the U.S. ensure our partners that we are committed to addressing the increase in violence against women?
Thank you so much for that question. And let me just start by saying that the administration is absolutely committed to women, peace, and security, to fighting against violence against women and sexual exploitation that we're seeing, including happening right now this day in Ukraine. The administration has to balance its budget request. Occasionally, in this balancing act of trying to prioritize everything, we don't always have the ability to ask for all the support that we need. But I thank you for your efforts, and know that even though the budget request is not the same, our commitment has not decreased. And we're also encouraging other countries to contribute to these efforts. So where the U.S. is not there in terms of funding, other countries hopefully will step in.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you. Now I will yield to Mr. Diaz-Bayard.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairwoman. Ambassador, good to see you in person. And let me also thank you for your years, your willingness to serve this great country of ours. I want to refer to something that subject that the ranking member touched on. In your statement, you talked about our multilateral engagement as delivering concrete outcomes for the U.S. and helping advance our values around the world. But the ranking member mentioned the Human Rights Council. You know, the Human Rights Council has had a unique fixation against Israel forever. And on May 2021, again, initiated yet another anti-Israeli inquiry, one that the administration has said it deeply regrets. So the question is, do you think that being there, you will be able to change that attitude? So far, obviously, it has not worked. And if not, you know, why continue to legitimize an organization that has a unique, I would say, anti-Semitic attitude towards Israel? That's question number one. Number two is, I don't have to tell you, you know very well that some of the world's worst human rights violators are part of that council, whether it's the PRC, Cuba, Bolivia, Venezuela, I can go on and on and on. And so I'm pleased that Russia was tossed out after, you know, a pretty obvious, you know, horrific act of historic proportions. Are you working with other colleagues to toss out the other human rights, at least the most egregious human rights violators in that group? If not, why not? And if so, and you may not be able to talk necessarily publicly about some of those efforts. But if so, I'd like to maybe later follow up with you as to what those efforts are. Because, again, I know that I'm sure that you would agree that having Cuba, Venezuela, China, others, you know, really becomes a sad joke. And it's, to me, it's very difficult to be part of an organization that doesn't even take itself seriously. And again, the question with the Israel situation or otherwise is why legitimize an organization if it continues, as it evidently is doing, particularly with the case of Israel, continue to target? And I think that's, you know, a clear demonstration of anti-Semitism. But anyway, so two questions. We don't have a lot of time. Good to see you, Ambassador.
Good. Thank you so much, and thank you for both of those questions. First, on the unfair targeting of Israel in the Human Rights Council. We have made clear over and over again that we will stand with Israel. We will fight against any of those efforts. This most recent commission of inquiry on the situation in Israel and the West Bank, we oppose that effort, and we've made clear our opposition to this commission of inquiry. It was established when we were not on the council. I can't say that if we'd been sitting on the council that we would have been able to block it, but we certainly would have been able to block and push back on this open-ended mandate that they were given. And we worked very, very hard in the Fifth Committee to cut the budget. We cut it by about 25%, and we will be working with other member states to do that over the course of this year. And in terms of the other members of the council, we can't agree with you more. We're sitting at the table with some pretty unsavory countries and unsavory people. But we know if we leave them to that table by themselves, they will take everything. And we have to make sure that we're sitting there to push back on them and push back on their efforts. What we're doing, Congressman, is trying to work with other countries to get countries that are supporters of human rights to stand up and run for seats on the council. Sometimes those countries are a little bit reticent about stepping up, and they won't step up if we're not there. So what I've heard from the good countries on the council is, thank God you're back. We couldn't handle this without you. We need you at the table. So not only do they need us at the table, but we need to make sure that we bring others like them to the table so that we can push the unsavory people that you mentioned away from the table.
I'm out of time. Thank you, Madam.
Now I will yield to Ms. Franklin, who's on virtually. Good morning, Ms. Franklin.
Yeah, hi. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Madam Ambassador, for being in front of us today. So first thing I want to ask you about is UNFPA and UN Women. I think I share the belief of many that when women succeed, the world succeeds, and that when girls and women have access to full health care, to education, they're free from violence, they have economic opportunities when they sit or at the table when important decisions are made, that their communities are much more peaceful and prosperous, and that means the world is too. So I'm going to support these two organizations. I see you've had a strong funding request for UNFPA and UN Women. Can you tell us how the United States is working with these organizations and what you see are the highlights of what they're doing?
Thank you, Congresswoman. Both of these organizations, UN Women and UNFPA, provide extraordinary support to women in terms of protection of their rights, protections of their health, and providing support to women. We had a briefing this week, I mentioned earlier, on Ukraine and the impact of violence against women, and that these women not only need our voices when these attacks happen, they actually need our support. They need our support for medical assistance. They need our support for psychosocial assistance. They need our support for protection, and both of these organizations have stepped up to provide that support. So we have engaged very closely with both the leadership of UNFPA and the leadership of UN Women to ensure that they provide the support that women across the world expect and need from them in order to not just live, but to survive. It's an issue of survival for many of these women. When I look at the situation in Afghanistan, where women are being constantly, their rights are constantly being taken away and restricted by the Taliban, they know that the world is standing and pushing back against the Taliban to ensure that we do everything possible to support them. We're engaging with them.
Madam?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, listen, I want to thank you. I just want to make sure I want to go on to one more item, if I can, because I want to just thank my friend, Mario Diaz-Balart, for raising the issue of the UN Human Rights Council, and I agree with him, and just strong opposition to their targeting of Israel. And I want to also convey my expectation that the United States repel that in every way possible. I also want to ask you about the United Nations Relief and Works Agency and ask you about their, specifically about their textbooks, which continue to contain anti-Israel and anti-Semitic content. Are we able to do anything about that?
That is one of the most important issues on our agenda in our engagements with UNRWA. I visited the region late last year, and I met with the UNRWA leadership, raised our concerns about these issues. The textbooks are actually printed by the Palestinian Authority, and I raised it directly with the Palestinian Authority when I met with them. And told them that this was really a red line for all of us. They hear your voices on this. They hear our voices on this. UNRWA has indicated that they have put inserts in all the books countering all of this misinformation and the anti-Semitic comments in the books. We want those books removed, at least the references in those books removed, and we've made that very clear to the Palestinian Authority, and they've committed to us that they would remove them. I have not seen that happen yet, but we will not stop until we see action taken on this. I will say and stress that UNRWA does provide other services that are important for the humanitarian assistance for Palestinians, and we've said to even to the Israeli government that it is important that UNRWA continues to provide that support to people who are in need. But they, we will be watching what they do on these textbooks and other there are other issues of management that we're working with them very closely on and have monitored their work in the coming year.
Thank you. I understand that. I yield back. Thank you, Madam.
Now I will yield to Mr. Reschenthaler.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I appreciate it. Madam Ambassador, thanks for being here today, and thanks for all your hard work. I'd like to focus on the World Health Organization to start off. The World Health Organization was founded, and I'm quoting directly, quote, give everyone, everywhere, an equal chance to live a healthy life, end quote. Great goal and mission, but I think it's irrefutable that that mission has morphed into kowtowing to communist China, parroting the talking points that are given to it by the CCP. And if you look at the beginning of the pandemic, the World Health Organization went out of its way to help the CCP cover up the true origins of this virus. Most recently, despite overwhelming international support, you had the World Health Organization deny Taiwan observer status in this year's annual assembly due to pressure, obviously, from communist China. And just a quick shout out to Taiwan. They're the first nation. Those scientists were the first ones to correctly identify this human-to-human transmission, not this conspiracy theory that the CCP and the World Health Organization were parroting, that this was a zoonotic disease that transmitted, obviously, from animals to humans. So, Madam Ambassador, do you oppose the World Health Organization's decision to deny Taiwan observer status?
Absolutely, categorically. We have raised our concerns with the World Health Organization and at the World Health Assembly that Taiwan was not allowed to participate. We think they should be allowed to participate. We think they add value, and we will keep pushing for that in the future until it happens.
Thanks for those efforts. And what about the just the malign influence that the CCP has over the World Health Organization? Because I still think the World Health Organization has a valid mission purpose if we could just stop the influence from Communist China. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I do, and thank you for raising that. We need to push back on the Chinese malign efforts in the World Health Organization. That's one of the reasons we wanted to make sure that we were back at the table, and we've been a leading voice in that organization calling for reform in the organization, but also pushing back against the influence that the Chinese have had, particularly as it relates recently to the origins of COVID. And we're pressing the Chinese government itself and the CCP to respond to the WHO request on the origins issue. I agree with you, sir. The World Health Organization does have an important role to play. We need to be there and be a leading voice in pushing for the reforms to allow them to improve on their current performance.
Thank you, Madam Ambassador. And I just wanted to continue speaking about China. As you know, Michelle Bachelet, who's the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, recently visited Communist China. And as you know, Communist China is actively involved in what I would describe egregious human rights violations. The oppression of Hong Kong, which should, by international law, be a free and independent city-state, part of the British Commonwealth, the religious persecution in Tibet, the ongoing genocide in the Xinjiang province. But after this visit, which Beijing highly restricted, the commissioner refused to condemn the genocide of the Uyghur Muslims. Ambassador, after witnessing the UN's just utter indifference to this genocide and to the other egregious actions from Tibet to Hong Kong to elsewhere, what are we doing to hold China accountable and push back on these human rights and political violations?
First, Congressman, we strongly and publicly oppose the High Commissioner's visit to China. We knew that it would not be unfettered. We knew that she could not come out of that visit with a transparent report that would provide us all of the evidence of the genocide that we know is taking place in China. For our part, we regularly expose this in the Security Council. We've held a number of meetings with our British colleagues and others to call out the Chinese on this issue. I regularly meet with Uyghurs whose family members have been held unfairly by the Chinese government and have raised those concerns directly with the Chinese government myself. And we will keep pushing on these efforts. We saw the report that the High Commissioner put out. None of us, in the U.S. as well as others, none of us were satisfied with that report. We've called for her to issue the report that was done previously that we know outlines the concerns that we've all raised.
Thank you, Madam Ambassador, and thank you, Madam Chair. I yield back.
Thank you. I'll yield now to Ms. Torres.
Thank you, Chairwoman Lee. Ambassador, I'm really happy to see you here today. I have been watching your work trying to rebuild U.S. engagement with the U.N. after, you know, the failed Trump administration at defunding those very important programs. So thank you for your tireless effort. And thank you to your staff for working so hard to once again rebuild the trust in our country with the world. Today, I want to hear more from you about what the Biden administration is doing in leveraging UN resources and expertise to address the migrant crisis in Central America. As you know, too many Central Americans are forced to flee their countries. We have over 500,000 asylum seekers and refugees from El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras specifically right now. I support the administration's goals in Central America to help stem the tide of migrants to the U.S. by ensuring that they have opportunities in their own home country and can see a future for themselves. These are, you know, young people that should have a bright future for themselves in their own countries if given the opportunity to have education and access to resources. So to do so, we must remain committed to fighting corruption in the region. We cannot allow taxpayers funding to support or sustain the corrupt actors that are there today. Ambassador Thomas Greenfield, the Office of the UN High Commissioner for Refugees works with the seven governments leading the Comprehensive Regional Protection and Solutions Framework, which is working toward innovative solutions to the displacement crisis in Central America. So what is the Biden administration doing to ensure these efforts help local communities and are not diverted to corrupt actors? And what can Congress do? What more can we do to help in that?
Thank you so much for that question. As you know, the Vice President has been leading our efforts on this front, and very early in that process, she reached out to me to ask that I ensure that I bring together the UN agencies and NGOs and donors together to look at how we can better address these issues. So I pulled together all of the UN agencies in New York last year for a comprehensive discussion on the situation in Latin America as it relates to the migrants. I brought together donors. There was an appeal made to donors, other donors. As you know, the U.S. is certainly the largest contributor, and the Office of Population, Refugees, and Migration has made a significant contribution to UNHCR's efforts in the seven nations, but we're pushing for other countries to engage on this as well.
Yes, the issue that I see and, you know, dealing in our own communities with, you know, trying to create good jobs to our local cities is no one wants to invest in a community that is plagued with corruption or high crime. So, you know, I'm very skeptical of how we can succeed and move forward if we are not directly calling out and addressing, you know, the issues, or at the very least, protecting and protecting might mean that we have to pull out and pull back our investment in the region. The UN has a long history of trying to support the rule of law and anti-corruption efforts in Central America by providing leadership for them to set up institutions to investigate public corruption. I know that. How can the Biden administration engage on these issues with the UN to make sure that our seven other partners, you know, are also focusing with us on that anti-corruption agenda?
Well, certainly the UN couldn't do it without the support of the United States. So as I noted earlier, we're a huge funder. But I will be leaving here today to go to the Summit of Americas, where we're bringing the democracies together to talk about the importance of democracy and even call out some of those countries where we see issues of corruption and human rights violation. And that is a huge step forward. And we've seen some progress. Ecuador is an amazing example of progress in that area.
Great progress. Thank you. And I yield back, Madam Chair.
Thank you. I will yield now to Ms. Letlow.
Thank you, Chairwoman Lee and Ranking Member Rogers. I'm incredibly honored to be joining all of you today as the newest member of the State and Foreign Operations Subcommittee, and I look forward to working with you and other members of the committee. Ambassador Thomas Greenfield, it's great to see a fellow Louisianan in this committee room today, and I look forward to working with you and the administration to provide the best possible oversight and stewardship of the United Nations mission budget. We're in the middle of a global food and security crisis, which has been exacerbated by Russia's invasion of Ukraine. As you know, the 5th District of Louisiana has numerous farmers who are ready to produce and provide food assistance during international crises. In our home state, we're used to quickly providing food assistance in the face of natural disasters. How do you see American agriculture being able to help with this crisis? Specifically, how will you advocate to the UN that American agriculture is ready to provide food assistance to countries in dire need at a time when many developing countries depend on Ukrainian food supply that has been decimated during this invasion?
Thank you so much, Representative, and it's great to see you here, and also great to be with someone from the great state of Louisiana, and I do look forward to working with you. You may know that one of my highest priorities at the UN has been to work on food insecurity. I held during my presidency last year a signature event focusing on food insecurity and conflict, and just last month during our presidency, we hosted a ministerial on food insecurity with a particular attention on the impact of Ukraine on food insecurity. And then we held in, as our presidency, a signature event bringing together about 40 countries to talk about how to address these issues and what we can do in our countries. So I am very, very proud that Louisiana is an agricultural state, one in which we can look for opportunities for farmers from Louisiana and elsewhere in the United States to start to work to fill in the gap. We've also brought private sector, and I know that private sector companies working out of Louisiana have been engaged in some of these discussions to see how we can support American farmers making a contribution. And I will certainly look forward to visiting with you and talking with some of those farmers when I'm next in Louisiana.
Thank you so much. I'd like to go back to an issue that I know many of us have concerns about on this committee. The UN Human Rights Council has had a disproportionate and biased focus on Israel, including their Commission of Inquiry that we spoke about today. Now that this administration has re-engaged the U.S.'s involvement with this council, what are we specifically doing to address this injustice against our ally Israel, and what actions should be taken to stop bias in other U.N. organizations against Israel?
Thank you, and that is one of my highest priorities. I talked about it during my hearing. I met with the Israeli ambassador to the United Nations just yesterday to talk about some of these issues, including our concerns about the Commission of Inquiry. So we're working hand in hand with the Israeli government as well as other partners who agree with us about the unfair targeting of Israel, particularly in the Human Rights Council, but even in the Security Council, where we have a meeting on Israel every single month focused on the Palestinians. And it is something that we disagree with. It is something we're fighting against. And I think at the Security, at the Human Rights Council, you will begin to see that our presence will make a difference. And in the Security Council, I'm pushing aggressively against this unfair targeting.
Sure. One last question. This administration has requested in its budget to fund the UN Population Fund at $56 million. Many of my colleagues and I have grave concerns that this fund continually promotes abortion services across the globe. The majority of Americans agree that our taxpayer dollars should not be funding abortion. Even more Americans agree that we should not be funding abortion overseas. Why does this administration continue to push for American taxpayer dollars to fund a radical anti-life agenda overseas?
Thank you so much for that question. And I will respond by saying the UNFPA provides really important support to women who have been the victims of violence. We provide support for reproductive health. I was talking to a woman who told me she had 7 children, and her own health was impacted in that the UNFPA provided her with the important support. So the main goal is not to provide for abortion, is to provide for reproductive health support and even psychological support for women who have been the victims of violence. And we think it's important that we be at the table, that we provide support to women for these kinds of services.
Thank you so much for your responses. I yield back.
Thank you. I yield now to Mr. Espaillat. Mr. Espaillat, I believe it's Ms. Wexton, and then we'll come back to you.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Ambassador Greenfield, for being with us here today. I've been following the recent visit to China by Michelle Bachelet, the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, just as Mr. Reschenthaler brought up. And as you're likely aware, there were some concerns leading up to the trip that COVID restrictions would be used as a cover to limit access and that the PRC would use this visit as a propaganda to support its narrative that everything is fine in Xinjiang, in Hong Kong, and in Tibet. And it looks like that's exactly what happened. From what I've read in the press coverage, the High Commissioner and her team did not get unfettered access. There were government officials with them everywhere that they went. And constituents of mine who have family in Xinjiang indicated that their family members were not allowed to leave their homes during the visit. In her visit with President Xi, she was quoted by state media praising China for, quote, protecting human rights. Now, she later issued a statement saying that wasn't true, that she never said that, but that's what the PRC, you know, indicated in their press release, in their coverage of it, and that's obviously very concerning. During the news conference, she assured everyone that the internment camps that house over 1 million Uyghurs had been dismantled, quote unquote, saying that she had been assured that was happening, despite the mountains of evidence that to the contrary, including recent satellite images showing that in fact they're accelerating the building of these. And that they're actually rapidly expanding. And when describing the PRC's brutal campaign against Uyghurs, the High Commissioner used PRC-approved terms like counterterrorism and de-radicalization and referred to the internment or concentration camps as VETCs, or Vocational Education Educational Training Centers, which is a slap in the face to those who have been victims of these camps and the people who have family who have been victims of these camps. The whole thing, frankly, reads like a hostage video. Except I'm not convinced that she actually doesn't believe it. You know, that's very concerning to me, and I believe it's very concerning to you. What's your takeaway, your observations of the visit, and do you think it was performed according to standards that are acceptable?
Let me answer your last question first. No, it was not. And we made clear before she took the trip our opposition to her taking such a trip. We also made clear that we did not believe that she would get unfettered, unhindered access to the areas where she could do a transparent assessment. So we discouraged her from making the trip, and including our engagement with her, we engaged with the Secretary General as well to express our concerns. Other countries also expressed their concerns to the High Commissioner about her trip, and we are disappointed with the kinds of public statements that she made when she returned. And I think that the families of Uyghurs who have experienced the atrocities that are being committed in this region feel very aggrieved. By what they saw from her trip.
So the OHCHR has been working on a long delayed report with regard to Xinjiang. And do you know if this is going to change the date of their report, or do you have any idea when it'll be coming out? And
We've been asking.
Do you have concerns that this visit is going to change the tenor of this report?
That remains to be seen. We know that the report was drafted. We asked for the report to be released. We asked early for the report to be released, and we have expressed our disappointment that the report was not released earlier. And we'll wait to see how it's changed by her visit. But I think if the report is significantly changed by the visit, it will diminish the importance of this report for dealing with the situation.
I think it will also fail to accurately reflect the brutality and the atrocities that are taking place as we speak.
I agree fully with you.
Thank you, Madam Ambassador. I'll yield back with that.
Thank you. I will yield now to Mr. Espaillat.
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Ambassador, for your comments today. Are in torture chambers and under inhumane conditions, being held by Russia, and that they are in fact victims of torture in the Kherson region of that country. Most of them are either journalists or pro-Ukrainian activists. And just this week, you declared at the UN Security Council that there are credible reports of atrocities committed by Russia's forces against civilians in the Ukraine, including horrific accounts of sexual violence. Last March, I, along with Representative Cicilline, introduced H.R. 964 in the House, condemning Russia's unlawful war of aggression in the Ukraine and urging the global community to hold Russia accountable for war crimes. To hold Vladimir Putin accountable for war crimes. What do you propose that we do collectively, both Congress and you at the UN, to really hold Russia accountable? As we heard today, they're holding currently 600 Ukrainians in torture chambers.
I'm not surprised by that news. It's horrific. We are hearing every single day of atrocities that are being committed by Russian soldiers in Ukraine. And every single day it gets worse and worse. And we have called the Russians out. They certainly use their disinformation machinery to push back against this, and we have to be on guard every day to stand up to that disinformation campaign. They would have us believe that the Ukrainians themselves are doing this to themselves, despite the fact that we know that that is not the case. We have called these war crimes. We called it war crimes very early on, and we do believe strongly that they need to be held accountable. Some of the things that we might do to support holding them accountable is, and we're doing some of those already, providing support to the Ukrainian prosecutor's office to gather documentation and evidence to use against the Russians, supporting the efforts of the International Court of Justice that also called for the accountability by the Russians, and the ICC, which we're not a member of, but have definitely support them getting the evidence that they need to hold the Russians accountable. And we're holding them accountable every single day by the isolation that we are ensuring that they feel in the Security Council and around the world, kicking them off the Human Rights Council. They've also been kicked off a number of other UN agencies and bodies as well. And that is our message to the Russians, that we will not treat them as if it's business as usual after they've committed the kinds of atrocities they've committed in Ukraine.
Real quickly, you mentioned that you will be going to the Summit of the Americas. I will be part of a delegation that travels there as well. There was a concern with China's incursion in the hemisphere and the fact that we as a nation, the United States, fails to deliver to Latin American and Caribbean countries in significant ways, and that, frankly, they're eating our lunch. And unless we go with something in our hands to that summit, we will be embarrassed once again. What do you propose that we do?
You know, the summit is a start of renewing our push with our partners in Latin America. I will tell you that in New York, I hear every day from Caribbean and Latin American colleagues, they don't want to partner with China, but many of them feel they have no choice but partner with China because we have not been there for them. So we do, Congressman, have to ramp up our engagement with these countries.
I mean, it's been decades since the U.S. has had a major program, a major initiative in Latin America and the Caribbean. And so we're in a bad place. They don't want to do it, but they're forced to.
And I agree with you, and I think Congress has a role to play in supporting our efforts and our requests for assistance, but also in giving us advice on how you think we might better engage.
Thank you. You're back.
Okay. Well, Ambassador Thomas Greenfield, first of all, we're grateful for your dedication to diplomacy and for representing America on the world stage and for your time this morning. And I think you have heard and seen all of our committees who are committed, regardless of party, to global peace and security. And we appreciate your leadership. And we don't have time for another round, so I will close by just following up with Mr. Espaillat's point. I, too, will be participating in the Summit of the Americas. I was also with President Obama in Panama. And once again, here we are with the same issues. And I would just add Africa to Latin America and the Caribbean, where the United States has been missing in action, quite frankly. And so at some point, I'd like to have a roundtable or a discussion with you and members of our committee about what you think the path forward is to, I say, repair the damage of the past. So, Mr. Rogers, would you like to have any closing remarks?
Well, we appreciate your being here with us today and generous with your time and your opinion. We thank you for your service to the country. I was going to ask you about Iran and what's going on there, because we now hear that they're nearing a nuclear bomb capability. But nevertheless, good luck in your work. Godspeed in your service.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Ambassador. Let me just also say your testimony today will really help inform us as we craft our fiscal 2023 appropriations bill. And we appreciate your being here. And members will have 7 days to submit questions for the record. And we're confident we'll receive the response because members really are very serious about this work, and your being here today really validates and verifies that America is back. America is engaging in the world, and with your leadership, we know that we're going to achieve the goals of peace and security. So thank you again, Madam Ambassador.
Thank you.
This concludes today's hearing. The Subcommittee on State Foreign Operations and Related Programs stands adjourned. Thank you again.